And so if you had anything you needed in it, it needs to be in there by Monday.
Friday.
Oh, somebody told me Monday. Well, I'm glad I got mine done already. So kind of turn a little bit and greet each other in the Lord this morning and wave. And so, welcome everybody this morning. It's a beautiful day out there and the sun is shining. The geese are flying and the robins are around. And there's just a lot of activity going on that spring is promised. So let's begin this morning. Please join me in the gathering. Do you not know? Have you not heard? In Christ you are a new creation. Yes, you. Not someone else. You. For me. For everyone here, and to those who are watching, Christ has blotted out our sins, redeemed us through God's love and grace, and made us a new people. Welcome, new creations. Christ has given us life, and welcome us home. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, as we come into your presence this morning, this is not the first time that you have seen us this morning, O Lord, but we come here to gather as the body of Christ, those who lift up the name of Jesus, our Lord and our Savior, those that speak with you every day, and those that rely and trust upon you, the Lord God, and upon you, the Lord Jesus Christ, and upon your Holy Spirit. How can we not but come to worship you, to praise you in adoration, and just open our hearts unto you that swell with the love for you, the Lord God Almighty, the Son, and the Spirit. Please join us this day, Holy Spirit, and have your way fully in our hearts, our lives, and in this place. In the blessed name of Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior. Amen. Our new song is, and we've done it a while, At the Cross. So it's on the screen up.
There's a place where mercy reigns and never dies. There's a place where streams of grace flow deep and wide, where all the love ever found comes like a flood, comes flowing down at the cross. At the cross, I surrender my life. I'm in all of you. I'm in.
Please join me in the call to worship. Let the faithful come forth and enter the house of God. Let our prayers rise to the loving ears of God. For this is our hiding place, where the one who always loves us is waiting. May God's love surround us and hold us close. May our cries be heard and our sins forgiven. May our hearts be comforted and our joys renewed. May our worship be a blessing to one and all. Please take a moment of silence to yield to the Holy Spirit. Please join me in the Apostles' Creed, found in the bulletin. A statement of faith. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. On the third day he arose from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth at the right hand of God, the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, and the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Please hear these words of assurance. All who call in the name of the Lord are answered. God's steadfast love endures forever. God is by your side. There is nothing to be afraid of. The Lord stands beside you to help. This is the day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. Please turn or on the screen to number 70. Please be seated. Do we have any testimonies today of God's great love and what he has done for us this last week?
I was reading in the upper room on Thursday.
Got to talk a little bit louder.
Thursday, the upper room was about your fearful and wonderful name.
Okay. Very true.
Kind of crazy, though, went from that to reading it.
Yeah. God answers us in so many different ways, so many different ways. And we all have to remember that we're looking at the world through our opinion.
Yeah.
And some days it's a little tainted and a little off. So, but we are the work of Christ, and Christ reminds us of that, that we are still a work in progress, and he is patiently walks with us through that. So, anybody else this morning? Rachel.
Yesterday we had a get together with John's family and his aunt. We prayed for her. She has pancreatic cancer and has chosen quality. And we had a really great day. We made a craft project and there was a new baby there that we all got to meet with. new life comes and yeah. the circle. And
she can be part of that
she
yesterday.
She can be part of that and make yeah. and take pictures with the new baby. Yeah.
James.
On Thursday, I was wrestling, and my arm got snapped in the mat, and I just sprained a muscle, but thank God it wasn't the whole arm that I got broke.
Hallelujah. Very good. And I heard that you also shared with Penny that we've been praying for
yes.
her. Very good. Very good. God is at work here. So anything else this morning? Let's just praise the Lord. Thank you, Lord, for all that you do for us. So. This morning we are going to, I have a letter from Barabbas this morning that I will be sharing with you. So of his journey to the cross. And it's quite a journey for Barabbas. As we know, Barabbas was a gentleman that was chosen over Christ. So as we begin this morning, nothing is known of Barabbas beyond what the scriptures record. Matthew identifies him as a notorious prisoner. And the other gospel writers say that he was involved in robbery, insurrection, and murder. In prisoner waiting execution, he was unexpectedly acquitted when the chief priest manipulated the people and asked Pilate to release him rather than Jesus for the Passover tradition. As he begins his letter, it's early, just after sunrise, but already I'm awake, and thankfully too, for it has been a miserable night. I slept fitfully, terrorized by all too real dreams, which made sleep fearful venture, at least. With an effort, I turned my attention to the memories of a better time. For a moment, I was a boy again, roaming the hillsides of Judea. Then I was sharing the Passover in this very city with my family. And now, as at other time, comes the memories that defines my life. It is unbidden and unwelcomed, but it still comes. Even after all these years, my mother is weeping, and my father cannot speak. The Romans have killed my brother, the firstborn in our family. In that moment, the seed of hatred is planted in my heart, though it will be many years before it comes to fruition. The Romans say that I'm an insurrectionist, and I suppose they're right. Though I've never wanted to believe that, I've always thought of myself as a patriot, that some people call a zealot, a man who is willing to die for the freedom of his nation. In my younger years, that may have been true, but somewhere along the way, I changed. Hate replaced love, and I began to talk of killing rather than dying. Then I began to kill. First, it was just hated Romans. Then it was the collaborators, the tax collectors, and such the like. Then it was anyone who got in my way. In the process, I learned the bitter truth. Every time I killed, a part of me died, a part that was good and decent. And after a while, all that remained was the killing part. What I did and what I became were one in the same. The man who killed was now a killer, what the Romans call a revolutionist. For a while, I believed I was doing it to avenge my brother. Perhaps it began that way, but soon I killed just because I was a killer. The first time I took Roman life, it made me sick, but I soon got over it. Then I began to relish it, and finally, I needed it. Then I began to and I needed it. I was consumed with the lust for blood, not necessarily Roman either. As I near the end of my life, I realize I have become the very thing I set out to destroy. Too late, I discovered that you cannot destroy a monster without becoming one yourself. In the distance, the guard barks an order, jerking me from my melancholy thoughts. Then I heard the sound of the key grating in the lock. Finally, the cell door swings open, groaning as it turns on its rusty hinges. I watch in the dim light as a fellow prisoner is chained and led away. The ties to be braced, but there is more than a hint of fear in his eyes, the kind of look I've seen in the eyes of trapped animals. Shortly, the guards return, and the scene is repeated. Same sound, same pseudo courage, same sick fear. With cold finality, to the cell door slammed shut, another prisoner is led away to die at the hands of the hated Romans. Finally, I am the only one left, and then the guards return for me. Burlesquely, they order me from my cell, and for a moment, I am tempted to leap upon them, resisting the impulse. I smile grimly and extend my hands to receive the mantles. To my amazement, the guard simply turns away. "You're free," he snarls. "The governor has given you pardon. Someone else is going to die in your place." I am stunned. I cannot believe my ears. This is too good to be true. For just a moment I stand there, staring dumbly at their retreating backs. Then I burst into a fit of manic laughter. Running and jumping like a madman, I shout, "I'm free, I'm free, I'm not going to die." Pushing by the surly guards, I stagger up the steep stairs and into the morning light. Even at this early hour, the streets are jammed with people, and I allow the flow of the crowd to carry me along. Turning to the man on my left, I ask, "Does anyone know what's going on here?" Giving me a disgusted look, he says, "We're going to the place called the Skull. There's going to be a crucifixion. That's the last place I want to go." I work my way to the edge of the crowd, escaping into the side street. Soon I lose my way in the maze of narrow, twisting streets. It doesn't matter. I'm free. And my eyes drink in the colorful sights like a thirsty man gulping for water. The taste of freedom is on my tongue. The smell of freedom is in my nostrils. I'm alive once more. A fit of laughter seizes me again. I dance through the early morning crowd, kissing strangers at random. As fate would have it, though, I emerge on the Via della Rosa just in time to see the mob making its way up the hill towards me. Once more I turn to go, but something holds me back, a morbid curiosity, I suppose, to see the one who will die in my place. Catching sight of the narrow staircase, I climb halfway up to get a better view. Soon, I am joined on the stairs by the shop's pure cater. Front and center, I see my compatriots, each bearing the cross upon which he will die. Several paces behind them is the third man, so badly beaten as to be nearly unrecognizable. He too is carrying a cross, my cross, the one upon which I was supposed to die. As I watch, he staggers a few steps and then falls, the weight of the cross pinning him to the pavement. Instantly, a Roman whip bites into his bloody back. Involuntarily, I cringe. Even from the distance, I can hear the sodden splat of the hard leather burying itself into the raw flesh. The prisoner, though, I give him that. He doesn't utter a sound, not even so much as a groan. Finally, he makes it to his knees before falling back a second time. And not even the threat of that deadly whip can empower him to rise again. Angrily, the soldier grabs the nearest bystander and orders him to carry the fallen man's cross. A good thing, too, because anyone can see he is in no condition to carry it himself. From the crowd, a weeping woman runs to him, helps him to his feet, then quickly disappears back into the throng of onlookers, staggering from the pain and the loss of blood. He allows his eyes to roam over the sea of faces, searching, I think, for the woman. At last he speaks, and through his voice is raw with pain. His words are tender, filled both with compassion and foreboding. Daughter of Jerusalem, do not weep for me. Weep for yourselves and for your children. For the time will come when you will say, blessed are the barren women, the wombs that never bore and the breasts that never nursed. Then they will say to the mountains, fall on us, and to the hills, cover us. An impatient soldier screams an order. Another cracks his deadly whip. Without further delay, the death march is resumed. What, I wonder, did he do for such inhuman treatment at the hands of the Romans? Compatriots and revolutionaries and murderers as I am, yet neither of them were beaten. No doubt, he is the most dangerous man, an assassin, most likely, and guilty of ending the worthless life of some Roman dignitary. Turning to the proprietor, I asked him, what do you know about that one? Following my gaze, he studies the abused prisoner for a moment before replying, that's Jesus of Nazareth. He's a prophet. What did he do? Nothing worthy of death, I can assure you. I heard it said he healed the sick and he forgave sins, things like that. Someone said he even claimed to be the Son of God. The condemned men are now in the street directly below me. I hurry down the stairs and push my way into the crowd. It's the last place I want to be, but I am gripped with compelling curiosity about this one who will die in my place. After one final ascent, we arrive at the place of the skull, and the executions begin. Hard Roman hands hurl the prisoner's jaw. Heavy hammers strike huge spikes, splintering flesh and bone. Blood splatters. Women weep, and the mob goes mad. Instinctively, I sense There is nothing more happening here than, there's something more happening here than meets the eye. But for the life of me, I can't figure it out. Watching him suffer, I am haunted by a single thought. That should be me. The cross was meant for me. After a time, the light begins to fade, and I make my way down the hill and turn toward the city. There's no laughter now. No exuberant dancing in the streets. No kissing of strangers. Just a taste of death upon my tongue. His death. I wander aimlessly through the narrow, twisting streets, fleeting from the kaleidoscope of memories that now haunt me. For most among them is stark image of his abused body, spread eagle on a Roman cross. Grateful though I am to be alive, I cannot escape the lingering guilt. Somehow, it doesn't seem right that I should live while he dies in my place. So ends the reading of the letter of Barabbas. Little is known about Barabbas beyond the fact that he was an insurrectionist and a murderer. In truth, his anonymity suits him well, for he represents every member of our fallen race. Was Barabbas guilty of sins against God and man? So are we. For all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. Was Barabbas under the sentence of death? So are we. For the wages of sin is death. Was Barabbas undeserving of his pardon? So are we. For it is by grace that we have been saved through faith, and this is not of ourselves. It is a gift from God, not by works, so that no one can boast. In the truest sense, the cross upon which Jesus dies was intended not only for Barabbas, but for each one of us. My sins fashioned that cross, as did yours, and it was there that we should have died. But God had another idea. While we were still sinners, Christ died for us. He himself bore our sins in his body on the tree, so that we might die to sins and live for righteousness. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, you have revealed ourselves in Barabbas, but you have also revealed ourselves in Jesus Christ, the one who came and thought and lived as we were worthy for him to die on the cross for us, that he laid down his life before the Father, Lord, and before all humankind, that we might live, that we might dance and rejoice as Barabbas did in the streets, because our freedom was bought by Jesus Christ on purpose for our life to begin again in him, a relationship with our Lord and Savior, the Lord Jesus Christ. For him we offer praise and thanksgiving and glory and honor, and our hearts are open wide to bring him in, that he may live with us and we with him. In the blessed name of Jesus Christ, our Lord and our Savior. Amen. Our scripture lesson this morning is really not the one found in there. It starts out in John 17. And he looked towards heaven and said, Father, the time has come. Glorify your Son, so that your Son may glorify you just as you gave him authority over all mankind, so that he might give eternal life to all those whom you have given to him. And eternal life is this, to know you, the one true God, in whom you have sent Jesus the Messiah. How amazing is that? When it gets to the part that, so that he might give eternal life to all of those whom you have given him. All of us were given by the Lord God Almighty unto Jesus Christ our Lord. And as I read that this morning, and my heart went out, and it was to God. And to God I asked, Lord, who can I give to you that you would give to Christ? Because he loses none that God gives him. So who is on our list? All of us know people that we love dearly that do not know Jesus Christ. And you know by the way that their life is lived that they do not know Jesus Christ. Can we give them to the Lord God and ask him to give them to Jesus Christ? Of course. One thing we learn about Barabbas. He grew up, he went to the Passover, but he did not know the Lord Jesus Christ until the end of his life. And Jesus Christ, even at the end, changed his heart and let him truly see what he had become. And that's not who he believed who he was. He believed he was a patriot. He was doing it for all the right reasons. We lie to ourselves really well. We do. Until Christ enters in. And then we have to stop lying. A time will come on this land when someone who is not God will proclaim to be God. The only way that we can possibly know this deception is by knowing for ourselves the one true God, the one holy God, who gave us his word, who sent his Son, who has made everything possible for us to say, yes, Lord, here I am. I give my life to you. It is yours. But if we tell God no, we will not be able to tell who the false God is. So we, like Barabbas, have to look within. Whom do we serve? And the shout comes back, we serve the living Lord God Almighty and his Son, Jesus Christ, and the Holy Spirit. That's why we're here today. Because we have a personal relationship with Jesus Christ and his Father and through the Spirit. And we are the living children of the Lord God upon this land. We have much to be thankful for and much to celebrate, but we also have much to do in sharing this amazing, amazing love with others. Even if they don't want it, how are they going to know? But we do have it because God has put it within us. In the blessed name of Jesus Christ, amen. I would ask you to please turn your hymnals are on the board, and it is Stand Up for Jesus. And I do not expect this to be sung quietly. Okay.
Is there any prayer requests this day or praises or?
I would like to request, I went to my kidney doctor. And it's not good, and next visit, I'll on the kidney donor.
Clayton went to his kidney doctor, and next, and it's not good. Okay. And it might, you're looking for a donor? Okay. Okay. All right. Anybody else this morning?
Yes, I'd like to put Ernie and Sue Johnson in your prayers this morning. They lost their son on Friday in Sioux Falls, South Dakota. And I don't know anything more than that, just that 46 years old.
Ouch.
And they're going to need lots of prayers.
Okay.
Son,
Jensen?
Jensen.
Anybody else? James?
My aunt.
Okay. Okay. I will share with you, we should pray for Brian this day. He's up with his family up north, and so they are kind of gathered him in. And so if we would continue to pray, that God will just bring a touch upon him. Okay? In all ways, that young man should have been dead many times already. So God has kept him alive for a reason and a purpose. So, okay. Anything else this morning? Continue to pray for our nation, please. We need it desperately. So, okay. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Heavenly Father, as we come before you, I must always remind us that we are in the body of Christ. We stand in unity together. I think of us when we are praying together as the disciples that stood before the Lord came in, but they were all in unity, all in one accord. And each had different thoughts in their hearts, but they were still all in one accord. And so as we come to you this morning, Lord, we come together in one accord as your sweet body, O Lord. We thank you, O Lord, for all that you have done for each and every one of us, for knowing us by name, for knowing how many hairs are on our head, things that we do not even care about, but we are so glad and we rejoice that you know our names and we are written on the palm of your hand. How amazing are you, O Lord. We lift up Clayton to you, Lord. We just ask for your presence to be upon him now, O Lord, that the Holy Spirit will just enter in and bring a peace and a calm. But we also ask for him, the healing touch of Jesus Christ upon him, O Lord. He is a wonderful testimony of your amazing love, your blessings upon him. We pray for Ernie and Sue Jensen, Lord, at the loss of their son, O Lord. How the heart breaks and turns, and how the unbelief comes in. But we ask, Lord, that your peace will enter there first, that will just come in, even though the tears flow and the weeping is, that there will be peace of God there in that place. We pray for the family, Lord, and the loss of this, when it is so quickly, it is very difficult. But gather those round about them, O Lord, who would encourage them with your word, who would come and help them, Lord, and be with them. We thank you for the body of Christ, O Lord. We lift up to you Penny this day, O Lord. We thank you for the young witness that went and told her that we are praying for her in this church. We are praying for you, Penny, that the Lord would just touch you and bring all different kinds of possibilities to your life. that you will find joy. You will find strength. You will find promise in the name of Christ. And you will also bear witness of the testimony of what Jesus Christ has done in your life. For this we thank you, Lord, because you are a mighty God. We lift up now, O Lord, our silent prayers to you. Please join us in the prayer that the Lord taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. At this time, we'll receive our gifts and our offerings. Father, we bring these gifts unto you from grateful heart for a mighty God you are and for Jesus Christ. We so thank you for blessing us that we may give back. In the blessed name of Christ, we pray. Amen. Thanks. Please be seated. I asked Clayton if he would like to come up and be prayed for. So I am going to ask all of you, if you will please stand where you are, unless you feel God leading you up here to pray with us. And I'm going to have Clayton come forward as we pray. Place your hands upon the... In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, we anoint you with what Christ has told. Anoint with oil. Pray for healing in the name of Christ. Lord Jesus, you are our healer completely. You put this body together. You knit it together in his mother's womb. You know each and every part that is in here, and you know which parts don't work. We ask, and we ask you, Lord Jesus, in the name of Christ, be healed. In the name of Christ, your Lord and Savior. Be ye healed. In Jesus' name we pray, through his power and through his authority alone. But he has granted it unto us. Your healing touch upon Clayton, Lord, is mighty and powerful. And we praise and thank you in the name of Christ. Amen.
Amen.
Oh, wow. Holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty. Thank you, body of Christ, for witnessing to the love of Christ. God bless.
Thank you.
Now I'm running out of time. At this time, we have a song to sing. We've a story to tell to the nations. And we do. 569. On the grace and the peace and the joy of the Lord Jesus Christ, who is his anointing, has been with us this day. We are in his presence. So go with him. Learn a lesson also from Barabbas to remember little things can turn into huge things. if we feed them too often. Stop when they're little, but go always. Run to him whose arms are wide open to you. In the blessed name of Christ. Go in grace and peace. In the blessed name of Jesus Christ, our Lord and our Savior. Hallelujah and amen. God bless.